I didn't grow up in Dallas. I grew old in Dallas. Graduated from high school, moved to Austin, and enrolled at UT. Studied genetic biology, with a particular focus on blood transfusion. I was fascinated with what happens on a cellular level when you mix your blood with someone else's and create a one-of-a-kind plasmic DNA cocktail. And the moment your veins take a sip of that cocktail, you become a new person, born again, biologically speaking, that is. My professors loved me, right up until they found out whose DNA was flowing through my veins, and then they flunked my Ruski ass right out of school. After that, I had to make some money, so I got myself a job tending bar. Every night, I would descend into my laboratory and search for the cure. Only problem? I had no idea what the malady was. But I was in heaven. Happiest 9 months of my life. Then one night, I'm driving home from the bar, smoking a joint and listening to...
Stars shining bright above you. Night breezes seem to whisper, I love you. Birds singing in the sycamore trees. Dream a little dream of me.
When out of nowhere, this blood-red Mercedes convertible flies through a red light, clips my front fender, and suddenly I'm spinning round and round, this one streetlight flashing before my eyes. Light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, light. And I see that the Mercedes has wrapped itself around a telephone pole, like a lover holding on for dear life. There's a fine mist of Stolichnaya floating in the air. I know that smell. My mother used to drink it in deepest, darkest night when the past came calling for her. I get out of my car and walk over to the Mercedes. The driver's face is pale, almost like a clown's. Then I realize that he's covered in a thin coat of virgin white powder. I run my finger across it and taste the jungles of Colombia. And the faux gas the villagers were cooking that beautiful spring morning in My Lai, when the GIs marched into their lives and never marched out. And something else that I can't quite place, something far away that hasn't even happened yet. And even though the guy in the car is dead, I want to get help, but the streets are empty, as if the whole world has been abandoned. But then this car approaches, one of those big black Lincoln town cars, and I go out into the street to wave it down, but it just drives right past me, nice and slow. These two tall white guys in dark suits inside, gazing right through me, their eyes ice blue and dead. They keep going, but when they reach the end of the block, they do a quick U-turn, and my soul goes numb. I run back to my car. Please start. Yes. Clutch. First gear. Go, go, go. Don't stop. Don't look back. Don't turn to dust. I turn left and right and right and left and right. And finally, they vanish from the mirror that shows us the past. And I'm home. I crawl into bed, finish my joint, and sleep. I can sleep because I know I didn't kill the man in the blood-red Mercedes. I mean, that guy was a suicide driver. He was like a dream you keep waking up from and then dream again, and wake up from and dream again, and again, and again, and again. Then the years passed me by, the way they always seem to do, until one afternoon, I'm walking through Midtown Manhattan, and I pass this Radio Shack, and all the TV screens in the window are showing a close-up of this really weird-looking guy. There's something not completely human about him. His face keeps contorting, and his skin is glowing like some genetically modified orange. And then I recognize him. It's the dead guy from the blood red Mercedes. And he's shouting like a madman to this huge, adoring crowd, and he's running for presidente. And like some bad movie nightmare you can never quite wake up from, the dead guy actually wins the election and becomes presidente. At first, he's not quite the nightmare everybody expected. But then, one beautiful morning about 9 months later, I'm doing the walk of shame through Soho after a night with some guy who's married to someone who's not me, which makes me think, you know, maybe it's time for a change. And I guess it really is time, because just then I see this plane float gently into World Trade Center 1. And a little while later, I see another plane float gently into World Trade Center 2, just so the first one won't feel so lonely. And I keep walking downtown towards the burning towers, because even though they're still standing, I can already feel them wanting to fall. And then they do fall, imploding into a billowing swirl of weightless dust, just like the powder on the dead guy's face. A white, cottony cloud calmly rolling down the street. And it is beautiful. And I think, this could enlighten us. This could wash away our sins. And just then I noticed this car parked right across the street from me. A black Lincoln Town Car, just like the one at the car crash all those years before. The same two tall white guys in the same dark suits inside, gazing right through me with the same dead blue eyes. They get out of the car and start strolling my way, as if they've got all the time in the world. So I vanish into the beautiful cloud of snow-white dust, because I know that they've come for me. And because I know that there's something inside the cloud that I need to find. I lose the white man in the white cloud and make my way to Port Authority, catch a midnight bus to Mexico City, and lay low among the multitudes for years. Right through the invasion of Iraq and then the ensuing DIV crisis. Until one day, the old blind woman at La Tienda tells me that people are falling like angels in El Norte. And now, the gringo hordes are headed this way. So the Mexicans are building a big, beautiful, million-mile wall to keep the güeros out. Y gracias a Dios, I made it out of that pinche shithole country just in time. And so I catch another bus. To Tijuana this time. Pay a coyote with a tunnel to move me in the wrong direction and slip me back across the border and under the wall and into the hotel. Because I know that I have to do something. Because I could have stopped El Presidente before he ever sunk his teeth into us. I could have stood up and told the world, this guy is a fucking dead man.
Ah.